Welcome to the second podcast of Preplaced. So, it's very excited to have you here. How's it going?
Hey, Abhishek. It's going great as of now. Second year has started. And what I heard about this startup was it's a nice initiative on you guys, on your part, that you're taking this up for different students, getting them the necessary training that a lot of them don't have exposure to. Really great. I mean, I'm proud to be a part of this initiative.
Yeah, thanks, man. We are also very excited to have you here. So how's it going? How's online MBA? Like, I guess your classes are online right now. How does that feel?
That's a very good question, actually. It's a question that has a very tangible as well as intangible element to it. So tangibly, it's what you can say that, yes, like there is no focused learning right now. With all the points that a professor would bring in would be more clear, direct, because right now the elements of physically teaching won't be there, right? So the person has to be more explicit and to the point and precise content-wise. And the second thing is that the intangible aspect here is the classroom, basically. Ultimately, when you're sitting together and in MBA college is the front row, first two rows that does class participation and the back row sleep. So you are missing out on that diversity of attitudes.
Correct. So just for everybody, for the people who are listening, Soham is currently a second year student in the business management program at XLRI. He has received a pre-placement offer from Bain & Company, and currently he's enrolled in XLRI. I think this is your last year, right? He's also a Placecom. He's a Placecom member at XLRI. Mammoth task, like, what do you think the placement scenario is like right now?
That's a very tricky question, honestly, because from what we know, like, there's a lot of fallout, like a domino effect that is going on, because post the corona outbreak in March, so a lot of joining of a lot of last year students of 2020 batch graduates have been delayed. Because of this, there's a spillover effect, and a lot of these processes have been shifted to later on, like for like across most colleges. So we are still figuring out on how to go about it and like what will be happening. And yeah, like, it's a work in progress, and we'll see as things materialize. And the company front, it's like, I mean, some companies will have reduced numbers, some might not hire. And at the same time, some other companies are fledglings which are growing at this point of time. And they are the future employers of India also.
Correct. So, like, there must be some companies which are hiring more in numbers. For example, I heard Amazon is hiring a lot. Like, I don't know about MBA grads, but they are hiring a lot of business analysts. So I guess it works both ways. Some businesses have just grown incredibly due to this virus epidemic.
Yeah, I think it's also a bit about how a company adopts the situation at hand. For example, if I take the case of Zoom, right? Zoom made a massive value proposition because of which it could capitalize on this entire outbreak. And also, for example, the businesses of AWS, GCP, Microsoft Azure, these cloud migration platforms and these IT companies, they are actively with companies in the overhauling of systems and digital transformation, which is leading to employment in some sectors, whereas at the same time, the balance sheet of those companies which have been affected, they might not be that easy to adopt, right? So it's a mix and match, I think, of the entire spectrum at hand.
Yeah, and some companies have also had to sort of rethink their business model and how they want to approach the markets, given their product market fit as to how they want to pitch themselves. Because upfront businesses, for example, Zomato, Swiggy, Oyo, all these businesses which actually require consumers to come at a particular place and, you know, just be there, that have been affected drastically. Whereas this entire online education, or as you said, Zoom and all these different services, online services, which engage users online and help them take interaction to the next level, this has increased a lot. So yeah, I get your point. Let's start from the beginning. It was a good introduction. Wanted to know, like, if you can tell us a bit about where you were post your BTech and what you did and what led you to pursue an MBA and finally being in company. How did that journey come about? Like, how did you envision it and how it actually happened? What are some of the pitfalls that you encountered?
That's a very vast question, which I'll try to wrap.
Absolutely. I'll pitch in at different intervals and, you know, guide.
Sure. I'll just give you a slight analogy. When people say that in an MBA interview, you go and you have to tell people that massively, like, everything that you've done in life has led you to this MBA interview right here. You sell yourself, right? So right. I would just say that has not been my case. When I graduated from NIT Rourkela in 2017, I had a sales job at Hilti. And I realized quickly that engineering was something that I could be only by name and by degree. I took up that role, and post, like, because of my PORs and all my previous experiences as different extracurricular managers, I felt that I am good at MBA material, like every other engineer would think. And once I went to Hilti, I worked there for 4 months, and then I shifted over to DS Associates. It is in the consulting business. And it is one of the great places to work, and a lot of my seniors were there. And at that time, and also, like, a bit of inspiration was given to me by a few of my friends also, like from NIT and some of my school friends, who one of them who's from IIT Kharagpur, who had told me a bit about McKinsey, Bain, BCG. And it was from then that actually I could say that I kind of had a fascination for MBB. Like, what is this about? What is all this about? Like, what is that? And I thought that maybe ZS would be a step closer to it.
Right. Now, so it's like this select club that you had this fascination about.
Yeah, I think it was mostly because my friends who kind of gave me that exposure, my friends and seniors who had just gotten into MBB, who had given me that exposure, that is when I thought that maybe, like, okay, like, I just want to understand what is all this about. And then slowly I ventured into consulting. I saw what the different roles, dynamics is between clients, stakeholders, and like the analysts and everyone. So I kind of liked this entire problem solving entire exercise. And I thought that, yeah, I might as well want to do this for some more years in my life. And then I thought that a way to get into an MBB would be a premier top B school. So that is when I thought I might as well take CAT and CAT and ZAT. And ZAT happened. So that is my point till XLRI. And once we were in XLRI, I mean, we had a lot of guidance from our seniors, our alumnus, and who helped us prepare, who helped us give case preparation. And that is how, like, I ended up at Bain & Company. And that is the small nutshell.
Got it. So, like, just a statistical question, like, what percentage of the students, like, you have a cohort of around 400 students every year. So, like, percentage of those people are targeting a consult firm, and what percentage of it do they, like, actually makes it to a MBB firm, as you say, or let us say around the top 5 or 6 consultancy companies that come for placements?
I think so. It's like I told you, right? Like I had this fascination for MBB. Like a lot of people have that when they enter management, right? And I think it's kind of like a double-edged sword. And I'll tell you why it is a double-edged sword. Because on one hand, A, you are very fascinated. You want to do things and you want to ensure that you end up doing and you're determined to do it. And on the other hand, in case you don't make it, you feel like it is the end of the world, right? Which is not at all the case, absolutely. Like when one goes into an MBA, it is with the preconceived notion of there are select few companies that I want to go to. But I see that an MBA is much, much, much more than that. And yeah, it is true. Like me, like there are many other people who have this fascination that they want to get into some specific companies like consults or investment banking. And then if they don't make it, they feel that is entire 2 years is a waste, which I feel is a very bad trend that is there. I mean, an MBA, is, like I reiterate, it is a lot much more than that. And yeah, it's like almost 80-85% of the batch is interested for the top roles of consult that come on campus. And yeah, almost you can say out of that, roughly 10% would be the ones who make it to these companies.
Got it. So like 80%.
And honestly, I would also like to add that it is these 10%, it is by no way... Like there is this preconceived notion that these 10% are the best profiles or something like that. No, it's a lot more about the organization's fit with your profile. So this getting into this company does not entail that you are among the best or the best profiles on campus. It is a very wrong notion. It is all about having the correct fit.
Got it. So like there's a lot of randomness involved which you can't exactly control. It's also your past experience and profile that you bring along to the table and whether the company interviewing you really sees you fitting into the particular role it has chosen for you.
Exactly. That's the major crux of it.
Got it. So how a lot of investment banks, so I'm guessing majorly the focus for students is on investment banks and consult. So like you interned for in Bain & Company during the summers. So how was the experience of an online internship? Do you feel that you would have gained more if you had done it offline?
Yeah, I mean, that is a very good question. I mean, that is also if like 10 years down the line, I'm narrating this story over a glass of whiskey, right? I would be saying that I was the first batch of interns in the history of MBA who've done an internship sitting at home on a laptop on my own study table.
and still got in a PPO.
I think so. Let's park aside the PPO part for a while. I think if we let's deep dive into the point about this online internship first, because this online internship was something that people were really weary about. I mean, when you look at a sales role or a marketing strategy role or maybe an investment and consult role, so consult, sales, all of these roles entail that you have interactions with stakeholders like clients, like your own team. And along with other roles that are there, you have to have interactions to gauge whether an intern is fit or not.
Right.
So the main thing out here, the main challenge was two-pronged. One was on the individual level, whether you have to understand, you have to catch up things, and you have to like be very on your feet always, whether to understand what the deliverable is, what the task is, and whether you are understanding things properly, solving it correctly, aligning perfectly with your manager and seniors. And the other part is that the peer learning that would have happened had you been on the ground itself with other stakeholders, your other batchmates from top colleges, right, then that part was essentially missing. And of course, the parties, intern parties. Well, these experiences are missing, and hence it could not be called a wholesome traditionally. But compared to like other years, so So companies really stood up and they ensured that like individuals have a good experience. For example, I'll cite an instance where during my internship, we had the cyclone Amphan in Kolkata.
For three, four days
roughly, and that is 3-4 days is almost like a week out of an 8-week duration, right? So I did not have an internet connection. I was working on slow hotspot and we had to use a lot of internal company resources. So my data was draining. And this is the time when the company actually showed its class, when my intern company actually ensured that I would not be in a situation where I have to like compromise on anything or where like whether this will be held against me because I am disadvantaged. This is where the companies change how they evaluate their evaluation criteria. And this is what is the true thing about like good company. They will ensure that the intern is evaluated correctly as per the situation at hand. And this is what this entire transformation is about, where the companies can think on their feet or not. And I think Corona was a true test of this. If somebody tells me who led digital transformation in India, it would not be Narendra Modi. It would be coronavirus.
Nice. That's surely food to food for thought. So, I guess the only difference between like a really coveted company and some of the non-coveted companies in an MBA college is that that level of peer interaction and the networking that happens, I guess. Otherwise, I'm sure the rules are more or less the same. Like, it's either sales or business development or strategy, operations, consulting. But I'm guessing it's the peer, the kind of people that you meet in a really big company, for example, McKinsey or Bain, compared to the kind of company, people you... the group you are surrounded with in a lesser known company, that is the real game changer. Correct me if I'm wrong.
The thing is, like, see, I'll again tell you that when you say coveted and non-coveted and known and lesser known, so I'll give an example here. So there was a firm that had come on campus. It is a very less known firm, right? I'm not going to mention the name, of course. It's like it's there in the report. But so it had offered us a package of like 50 lakhs. All right. And it was an investment analysis firm, but very few people knew about it. And later on, once people researched more about it, they understood, oh, it's a big role and a big firm. So it, I think it's coveted and less coveted is more a function of the company's history with your institute. And how the your seniors have talked about it, how the super seniors have talked about it, how people, your own peers, have talked about it. Like, I think it's most a function of that, behind a company being coveted and less coveted. If an intern from a senior year tells me that a particular company has not been good with it during its internship phase, then that would be a drawback, right? That would make it less coveted for me. But at the same time, if somebody tells me that this company has been doing well and developing programs well, so that would be coveted, like aiding my learning and everything. So that would be a yeah.
I have a question. Like, what is the for the students in an MBA college, like you are in one of the top 4 or 5 MBA colleges in the country. So how much of a hold does entrepreneurship have in the hearts of the folks there? Like Bain and companies like Tata and Birla, they recruit for really amazing corporate roles. But like, let us say somebody wants to become an entrepreneur and he wants to do an MBA. He's confused about whether he should do an MBA or go for entrepreneurship straight up. There are a lot of people who tell him that, if you do an MBA, you gain a grand network. You will get to know more about the business. And, he's confused. So what is your take on it? Do you feel that an MBA will in general help you climb the corporate ladder faster and make you a really good person, someone who really understands how the corporate world and the structure works, and help one, you know, lead through the chain? Or do you feel that there are ways in which an MBA can also help an entrepreneur realizes his dreams of setting up a business from scratch?
That's a great question. Just one caveat there is at the outset, I'd like to mention, like, before I go on with my insights here, is that since I'm just in the second year of MBA, right? So I might not have that much of an idea on whether it would be like a corporate ladder acceleration, or like what it does to you or not. But I can state some examples that I've seen of my XLRI seniors that maybe could put things into perspective. What most of the seniors have told me that like an MBA would be essentially like helping you out to understand how an organization works, gives you the rigor, especially that rigor of like working almost, say something like for 24 hours with sleep of three hours to replenish yourself. So it gives you all of this rigor, it gives you a network, it gives you all of this, right? And maybe later on, it also gives you that brand on your CV that helps you be taken more seriously. But at the same time, the thing here is that a lot of people also tell you, there's a counter view here, is that MBA is more like just getting yourself a brand and nothing more. It's more like a easy acceleration program. So there are many views to all of this. And so what I'll tell you here is that currently different colleges have incubators associated with them, right? So they are fostering entrepreneurship within the organization, within the college. For example, if I talk about XLRI, XLRI has an incubator called XSEED, where XLRI students and XLRI alums can register their startups and try to get maybe some sort of space and sort of funding to go ahead. And that is where the ESL of XLRI has been very active on that front. And secondly, it is that I think it depends from person to person. Because say, for example, if there's somebody who's not from a business background, right, per se, and the person might feel that they might not have what it takes to carry on with a business, right? They might not feel that they have what it takes, the courage. So they might go for an MBA, and maybe after a few years, they feel that they kind of understand things more suitably, and they have a brand value for themselves. So that even if they fail, they can come back to a certain job, right? And that is where they venture into. I'll give you two key examples. One is of our 2014 alumnus called Varun Mahana. So if you have heard of a startup called Poker Dangal, so he's the founder of Poker Dangal. And he's doing pretty well. He's like giving tough competition to Adda 52, Dream 11. And he's one of the top 5 poker playing startups. Then if you also heard about a company called Farmeasy is a startup of Dr. Dhaval Shah, who's also 2016 or 15 alumnus, who was also the GenSec of XLRI. So there are many such, alums who have been like partners and founders of different VC funds also. And so on. So it's like there are numerous examples of people branching out later on. I think it's all about people finding their comfort zone. Once they find their comfort zone and find their inner confidence, that is when they propel themselves upwards. Some people have the passion things they have from their family. Some do not. And I think that is what is the key difference to whether one chooses to be an entrepreneur first or one chooses to do an MBA first and then an entrepreneurship. If that is the difference.
That was a very comprehensive answer, and I feel that you covered most of the points. So our startup Preplaced is basically a sort of online platform where people can, students who are actually in the dark about how different interviews for different roles are conducted, they can come here and they can book an interview slot. And some of our mentors get back to them and they take mock interviews. And we also provide different services like CV Funda and all of the any other kind of help that a student needs. So, you know, approaching this from that perspective, could you tell us a bit about how exactly you went about the process of preparing for Bain & Company? Whether you actually focused on consult companies for your in summer placements, or whether you were like preparing in general and you happened to get shortlisted in Bain, and you know, that placement process basically.
So I cannot divulge the details of the placement process per se, but maybe an overall funda here would be that I was preparing actually for the entire thing, to get my basics straight. For example, I would say that there is no particular role where you can say that I'll just prepare for Finn or I'll just prepare for marketing and I'll just go on, right? I mean, you need to have basics of a 4 P's of marketing as well as the basics of how of a difference between a liability and an asset. And I mean, you need to get all of these basics in place before you even think of maybe working on a project, right? As a business student. So I went about like preparing mostly like trying to understand a bit of the concepts and then trying to apply in different case interviews. So in the preparation of, firstly, like all top B schools, there would be seniors who would help you out in the preparation of your CVs. And then they will also help you in preparing for these interviews like marketing lectures, operations lectures, consulting case lectures. And these seniors will be the ones who will be taking, and it is these seniors who are the ones who will ensure that you are prepared when you enter that interview room. And once you enter the interview room, it is all of this preparation that pushes you ahead. And like apart from your own caliber, also and a bit of luck, and luck which is definitely important. I would never doubt that. But yeah, so it is all of this preparation that sets you apart, I mean, among all other candidates.
Right. So basically, there is a entire nurturing by the seniors, which help the first year students get placed, and then you know that's really nice to hear. I mean, there's a fair bit of interaction that happens between batches, I'm guessing.
Yes. And it is the ultimately. My senior also had once told me, one of my seniors before I joined Excel, that you. No first-year student will get placed if they don't have the seniors guiding them. Because it is these seniors overall, the senior batch, who gives you all the support. The entire ecosystem is of the seniors who ensured that you are prepped on the day of your interview. And that is your moment to shine. And of course, like you'll have to put in the hours and the hard work to ensure that you reach where you are. But again, like they say in Harry Potter, Hogwarts, like, in Hogwarts, you get the help that you deserve, right?
Correct.
So it's similar. You put in the hours, you put in the dedication, you will get all the help that you can ever need.
That's amazing.
And I think that on that point, like what you guys are doing is kind of a similar thing for many students who might not have that exposure or might not have the linkages. And this big senior... I could say this big senior ecosystem that you are fostering, although profitably. But I mean, I think this is a very good initiative on your part, like to ensure that people get that link, these linkages.
Great, thanks, man. So that brings me to my last question. So MBA back in let's say back 20 years ago. It was considered the select club. It was the, you know, you got access to this closed group of people where, you know, you built your network and they helped you go places. But just want your opinion on this. In today's world, given LinkedIn, given Naukri.com, given all these different networking events that are happening across cities, people just, you know, posting on IIM jobs for startup co-founders. So in today's day and age, how do you feel that whether an MBA really is required in order to gain an access to this to that sort of network, and also what other things does an MBA provide? You talked about what other things an MBA provides, of course, but like, how do you think that an MBA can evolve in today's day and age in order to provide a better value proposition to its students?
That's a fair question, and I think I'd like to handle it in two parts. First part would be about A, what an MBA provides, and B, like, what could be the future of probably of MBA in general.
Right.
So firstly, on the first context of what an MBA provides, I would say that right now, like I had mentioned, that apart from the network and the peer learning, the rigor that it gets you to train that for, and the rigor gives you that ownership for any sort of situation in the future. When you're a VP, like, you're sleeping at 3 in the night, and say you get a call that a particular territory's sales has gone down because of a particular situation. So you have to think on your feet, get your team together, drive the situation, and solve the problem, right? So
right. It
is this sort of a rigor, which I think somebody who's not in an MBA with long years of experience also can do, and can do it even better, I think. But at the same time, an MBA probably will give you that sort of exposure that, like, to solve this problem, say you're learning from another industry. So you're solving a sales problem for a FMCG company, but probably you're learning about, like, you're utilizing the skills that you learned while probably reading up on, say, something from the IT industry. So this learning between industries, this interdisciplinary learnings is something, and flow of information is something that an MBA does really well in the form of cases. The cases range on different subjects, on different companies, on different business problems. And you'll hear that a lot of people say that MBAs think in terms of framework. Well, that is a very popular myth. But I mean, like, obviously, like, we don't go around like thinking about whether we should drink coffee or tea and like make a like 4-piece chart for it, right? Or a PR diagram. Like, we don't do that. Like, what it these frameworks do is basically it gives you
it provides you a structure, basically.
Exactly. It just gives you a total road in which you know how it is to be thought, and it just ensures that you start thinking on that front, and slowly you add on to it. A structure is a dynamic thought process, ultimately. That, for example, if I want to evaluate how good a company is, right, I would start doing it two ways. First, I look at the external factors of it, like industry, etc., and then I look at the internal capabilities. Now, this entire concept of being MISI, right, mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive, this is something that an MBA provides well, so that it gives you a thought process. And from there, where you build on is completely up to you. So I think is this thought process which is a key takeaway, apart from all the network and everything and your contacts. Secondly, about the future. You were saying?
The concluding point is MBAs have a good structural base via which they can leverage in order to work on different business problems. Whereas non-MBAs or people who are uninitiated are just starting off from scratch, and they can either make it or break.
No, I mean, like, even an MBA can make or break, right? But it's like that is your talking about the outcome. But I'm just saying about thought process. One place there is a thought process, the other place there is no thought process yet, and it has to be created. And that is I'm saying. Like, of course, your entire structure and framework can change completely, totally. But again, it is something that, I mean, you build on and you put trial and error to it. And secondly, on the point of when you're talking about the future of MBA, I think that is a very, difficult discussion to have currently, considering all the situation at hand. I mean, yes, even MBA is going digital right now. with,
my question wasn't exactly about whether it's going digital or whether it'll be a program. My question is more in the sense that what else can we do to, like, the education that is being provided in an MBA is more or less along the lines of what was being provided 20 years ago. And the world has progressed over time, and different ways of imparting education are coming up. So, well, for example, gamification, and there are a lot of other such methods going around. So just wanted to know your thoughts as to how an MBA can evolve, and you know, whether there could be more industry exposure, whether live case studies, things like that, which an MBA program can use and give a better value proposition to its students.
Yeah. So, now I understood your question. And just to throw some context here, so all the colleges have these different tie-ups with different companies, like, say, P&G, Mondelez, Nestle, and so on, and like other companies. So all of these companies provide live projects for students to work on, and these are held in collaboration with different professors of different streams, who ensure that these are graded up, and also, so the company also provides their feedback, professors also provide their feedback, and like there are case competitions where people apply themselves. So if MBA is not just about the learning that you get in a classroom, right now it is the industry exposure through webinars, sessions, case launches, live projects, and internships. And this entire thing together ensures that you have a well-rounded understanding of a business. And it is not just a boardroom teaching that is helping you out here.
Right. You were saying already these things are happening.
Yes, it is.
Progress. Got it. That's amazing. I mean, I'm sure the value of an MBA will always be there. So,
I think it's all about the exposure, and how you get it is it's up to you. Either you can get it like from the beginning where you are born or where you are raised, or you can get it in your undergrad where you have that exposure, or you can get it in your MBA. I mean, it all depends on where you get that exposure to do what you want to do.
Got it. Yeah, I mean, there are so many ways to get that exposure. Some people, for example, travel just and they report social causes or something like that.
Exactly. I mean, also through traveling, you also see a point of where, Rivigo. Rivigo was founded by the founder when he was traveling across Rajasthan, and he had heard of the plights of truckers, right? I mean, these are like examples of successful startup stories. I mean, I could be factually wrong whether it's Rajasthan or which state, but I mean, it is this. This is the entire crux in which even traveling gives you that perspective, and. So,
and I feel like different experience give you different sort of exposure. I mean, traveling will probably teach you about the problems, day-to-day problems faced by a common man, whereas an MBA will give you in-depth exposure into business, and whereas an engineering degree, for example, a great idea about. So, what are the different exposures that you want, and how it all comes together?
Agreed. Yes.
Got it. So, this was very informative, and I'm sure that it will help the aspiring MBA students gain some perspective as to what they can achieve in an MBA. And maybe some of them will contact you if they have any more questions.
Sure, that definitely works. Always open to help anyone out.